Hi students, welcome to Crash Course. Yesterday we discussed about the introduction of chemical bonding and the Causalis octet theory, and next about the next point of ionic bonding, types of ionic bond and about the factors available for ionic bond formation, and next about Poisson's rules, that is polarization and covalent character in ionic bond. And one more point about the ionic bond, that is crystal lattice energy. Crystal lattice energy. Here, crystal lattice energy, how we can calculate? The crystal lattice energy, how we can calculate means, here, crystal lattice energy means what? First of all, suppose if we are having a sodium plus gaseous ion and Cl minus gaseous ion, if they are combining, it gives a 1 mole of NaCl solid, and here delta H, the energy released is 769.96 kilojoules per mole energy. The amount of energy released here, please remember, the amount of energy released during the formation of 1 mole of ionic crystal from the oppositely charged gaseous ions is called as crystal lattice energy. Okay, but is it possible to calculate this crystal lattice energy value directly? No. Why? Because is in nature what we have means sodium gaseous ion. Is it possible? No. Sodium gaseous ions are not present in nature, and Cl minus gaseous ions are also not present. What are present in nature means sodium is present in solid state and chlorine is present in the gaseous state and molecular state. To get one NaCl, half molecule of chlorine is enough. So when we are combining, we are getting one mole of NaCl solid. And here the energy released is same or not, we will check. In practically they observed it is 410.5 kilojoules per mole only. Here also we are getting one mole, here also we are getting one mole, but both are not same. So what we can do? So here this is called as actually heat of formation. Heat of formation of one mole of ionic compound from their constituent elements present in their standard states or natural state. So this is heat of formation only. So how we can get the crystal lattice energy? It is not possible directly, we are going for indirect method. And the indirect method is based on Born-Haber cycle. Okay, so the indirect method is based on the Born-Haber cycle. The Born-Haber cycle will works basing on Hess law. So, according to Hess law, here a reaction is carried in one step or a reaction is carried in multi steps. The energy released or absorbed is same. That is simply Hess law. When we are going to your home from one direct route, or when we are going to home in different shortcut ways or in different ways, the release reached energy, reached means here home, we are reaching to the same. That is like a same concept. Here the energy released or absorbed is same when a reaction is carried in one step or in multi steps. Suppose actually or naturally we have solid sodium and gaseous chlorine molecule. In multi-step we are trying to convert into gaseous ions first. So first sodium solid we have. This sodium solid is converted into sodium gaseous ion. And this process is called as sublimation. And here the released energy or absorbed energy means it is always absorbed. Gaseous solid to gas conversion means sublimation, energy is absorbed. And sodium gas is converted to sodium plus gaseous ion. Here for the sodium plus gaseous ion formation, the energy here it is, what is happening? Yes, it is called as ionization potential. And here also energy is absorbed, that is delta H2. Next. Chlorine molecule is first converted to chlorine atom. When a molecule is dissociated into atom means, yes, it is called as dissociation energy. And here this is called as delta H3. And chlorine atom is converted to Cl minus gaseous ion, and here chlorine atom to Cl minus formation means, yes, this is called as electron affinity. Here energy is released, that is indicated with delta H4. Now we have Na plus gaseous ion, Cl minus gaseous ion. Now I am combining these two, and I am combining to form 1 mole of NaCl. So 1 mole of NaCl we are getting, and here the energy released is U, which is equal to delta of H5. This is called as crystal lattice energy. So as per Hess law, when a reaction is carried in one step means directly it is converting into this is a single step process, and the energy released delta HF is equal to multi-step process. Here multi-step means by following all the steps H1, H2, H3, H4 and H5. Delta H1 plus delta H2 plus delta H3 plus delta H4 plus delta H5. So when a reaction is carried in a single step or reaction is carried in multi-step, the energy released or absorbed is same. From this, delta H5 value is calculated. Here delta H5 is equal to -769.96 kilojoules energy is calculated. That is called as crystal lattice energy. Okay. Next, another important point, actually hydration energy and lattice energy, how we can relate them. This is mainly used for checking the compound solubility, whether the compound is soluble or insoluble can be explained basing on the hydration energies and lattice energies. Okay, hydration energy and lattice energy calculation, how we can say. So in the hydration energy and lattice energy, how the relation? Suppose if a hydration energy and a lattice energy relation is taken, hydration energy is greater than lattice energy of an ionic compound, then it is simply called as soluble. In that particular solvent, that ionic compound is soluble. If hydration energy is less than lattice energy, then that is called as insoluble. It is simply called as a precipitated. It becomes a precipitate. And if hydration energy relation is taken, hydration energy is directly proportional to Z plus and Z minus, or hydration energy is inversely proportional to 1 by R plus plus 1 by R minus. Okay, that is relation of hydration energy with the charge and size. You please remember this also, which is useful for solubility. Next, about covalent bond. Here covalent bond, when we are taking here a covalent bond means simply it is formed by the mutual sharing of electron pair between two similar or dissimilar atoms to get the nearest octet configuration. Generally, suppose hydrogen is present, here hydrogen in the valence shell, one electron is present. If they are sharing the electrons, and then it forms a H single bond H molecule, it is getting helium configuration, this is also getting helium configuration. Similarly, oxygen, if you are taking, in the valence shell, oxygen contains 6 electrons, and two single electrons are present, those are shared between the two oxygen atoms, and now each oxygen is getting 8 electron configuration, and between two oxygen atoms there is a double bond formation. Similarly, nitrogen, here 1, 2, 3, and here 1 electron second, and another nitrogen, 1, 2, 3, here one more electron, and then it is sharing all these 6 electrons, and then it is forming 3 bonds, that is called as a triple bond. A triple bond is formed between 2 nitrogen atoms. And here covalent bonds, when we are taking, it is mainly 2 types of covalent bonds. One is called as a non-polar covalent bond, and the second one is called as polar covalent bond. The second type is called as polar covalent bond. Polar covalent bond. Here, non-polar covalent bond and polar covalent bond. Non-polar covalent bond means, the example for non-polar covalent bond, please remember, if the electronegativity difference is equal to 0, electronegativity difference is equal to 0 between two atoms. Example, homodiatomic molecules, generally H2 or F2, Cl2, O2, N2, all these are considered as non-polar covalent bonds. Polar covalent bond means, if the electronegativity difference, here if the electronegativity difference is not equal to 0, means between two dissimilar atoms, between two dissimilar means different atoms. Example, HCl or NH3 or H2O or CH4. That type of molecules are called as polar covalent bond containing molecules, and these are called as non-polar covalent bond containing molecules.